Hi guys, Robert McGowan here.
It's another mixed bag weather-wise in Scotland today. We've got sunshine and showers as always. So I thought I'd pull over and do a wee quick video on the subject of which Porsches are most likely to hold their value or even possibly slightly appreciate in value. And we're going to cover quite a lot of different Porsche types in this video. And the idea is to give someone who's quite new to the Porsche mark a basic understanding about what to expect and what kind of, or what types of Porsches, like I say, are most likely to hold their value or potentially appreciate maybe just a little bit, or sometimes more in some cases. So it's not meant to be an in-depth look at the models themselves. I'm going to give you a wee snapshot of them without too much details of them, more about when they were made and the type, so that you can look into it yourself a bit further if you're interested in any of these cars and do a wee bit more research, which you should always do anyway, of course. So let's get started.
Try and structure this video in such a way where we talk about the cars that were not mass produced, and that means talking about any Porsche that was made before 1998. So if we look back at the back catalogue from anything before 1998, of which I'm sure you know it's a substantial amount of cars actually, pretty much almost anything pre this year is going to potentially hold its value or possibly maybe appreciate a little bit. The reason for that is because they're comparatively rare vehicles, and that's one of the things that makes a car possibly collectible or desirable in some ways. And all Porsches are desirable, but some have got more historical importance than others. But anything pre 1998, before Porsches were mass made, has got a particular type of appeal and a type of value. That's not to say that anything after 1998 is not collectible or going to appreciate or hold its value. There certainly is a large number of Porsches that will absolutely do that, and we'll talk about those later in the video. But to get started, let's just go way back in time and talk about anything pre-1998, and that means starting at the very start. That means talking about the very first official Porsche sports car, and that's a Type 356. Type 356 in forms A, B and C was made between 1948 and 1965, and it's actually an evolution of the Volkswagen Beetle and the Type 64 Porsche. The Type 64 Porsche was a really state-of-the-art machine made by Porsche. It was made in a wind tunnel, very aerodynamic, very distinctive, very rare cars, only three of them that get made. And from that, obviously, the Volkswagen Beetle was made by Porsche as well. So taking these two cars, roughly combining them, Porsche came up with the Type 356 and Types A, B and C. It's very successful, as you can imagine, a wee rear-wheel drive, compact, air-cooled sports car. A huge success for Porsche, did really well in the racetrack, and it really did kickstart Porsche's career into the mainstream, you know, gigantic superstar that they are today. Well, I'll use too much in this video, guys, but the 356 is a very valuable piece of kit, you can imagine, very expensive. So from there we can go to the next car, that's the Porsche 911. And we can talk about it way back to when it started in 1964, and we'll stick with the air-cooled 911s right now. So that's all types of 911 from 1964 to 1998. Every single variation, Targa, Cabriolet, Coupe, all the kind of mainstream models, if you like, all different types of 911s, of which there were several evolutions. They're all desirable, they're all expensive, and they're all fairly collectible. And I would imagine all air-cooled 911s of all guises will certainly hold their money in the medium to long term. Some will go up in value more than others. We could talk about special editions. Any special editions of any kind of Porsche, but in particular the 911s, like the RS, the 2.7 RS, or the 911 Turbos, or anything like that, even the 993 GT2, any kind of special edition 911 is potentially even more collectible, and because of its rarity and of its historical importance. So just to kind of summarise, we'll go back to 911s, but anything air-cooled, the 911 from 1964 to 1998, every single one of them in all types are all very pretty much collectible now because they're so rare, and will all hold their value pretty well or potentially climb a little bit. Again, this is my opinion. And this video is all my opinion. I've not scripted it. It's really just streaming my thoughts on which cars I think at this given moment in time are going to potentially hold their value. This is going to be subject to regional variations, where you are in the world, what's going on in the economic climate at the time. All these things have played a big part on values in car markets. So you've really got to do your own sort of a due diligence and check out your own regional market at any given time to make sure that it's up to date.
You should do that as a matter of course anyway, to be honest.
Yeah, the Porsche 912 from 1965 to 1969, it looks identical to the 911. The only one of the major differences is it's been detuned. It's got a four-pot air-cooled engine rather than a flat six, so it's a wee bit less powerful. But again, almost identical in looks to the 911 of that time. And these cars, again, are very rare, and they've become very collectible as well. A beautiful wee cars, lovely, not very powerful, like I say, but lovely to drive. And a 912 should absolutely hold its money, I would imagine. And I don't see them depreciating anytime soon.
914/916 was made from 1970 to 1976.
It's a wee quirky air-cooled, mid-engined, targa-topped Porsche. It's quite a unique-looking wee thing. It's mostly, you know, it's kind of Volkswagen influenced. It's got a wee soap bar profile. These things were out of favour for a long, long time, but they've actually seen a resurgence. Again, they're very quirky wee cars, not particularly fast, but they are very balanced, almost perfect weight distribution, being mid-engined, and they're very good fun to drive, as are all Porsches. So that's another car that, in my opinion, is most likely to hold its value pretty well in the long term.
Into the mid-70s, we start talking about the transaxle type Porsches, as they're sometimes called. So that started with the 924, and the 924 was from 1976 to 1988. It was made mostly using Volkswagen and Audi parts. It was Porsche's entry level at the time for quite a while. You would recognise those cars, they're quite distinctive looking. But then the Porsche 924 Turbo was from 1979 to 1984. Faster version, obviously, the 924, a wee bit more rare. You don't see these as much, they're nice looking cars. But one of the interesting things is worth mentioning about the 924 was the Carrera GT that came out in 1980. Yeah, that's right, there was a Carrera GT 924 type that came out in 1980. Quite an aggressive looking thing with scoops. Again, very rare and expensive. And these cars, like I say, any special edition like that is certainly going to potentially appreciate in value a wee bit more than the other ones. Subject to other variables, of course. So the 924, that kicked off the transaxle area, if you like. 944 came out in 1982 and it was built to 1981.
It's pretty much like a bigger brother of the 924. It looks quite similar, a bit more muscly, a bit more curvy, a bit more powerful. Pop-up headlights again, and it's lovely. The 944 is a fantastic Porsche. It's well engineered. It's got that typical over-engineered feel that all old Porsches have. And the 944 is a lovely piece of kit. The 944 Turbo came out from 1985 and was built to 1991. Obviously it's a 944 Turbo, so it's a bit faster. And these cars are worth a bit more than the basic 944, as are all turbos generally. So the 944 Turbo was a fantastic car.
It's a fantastic car.
1978, albeit there's another handful built shortly after that as well. But they weren't mass-produced, and in fact Porsche lost money in every single one of them that they made. The beautiful thing, I've actually had the pleasure of sitting in one not too far from here. Back in 1988, the Glen Vargo Porsche Centre, near where I used to live, actually had a Porsche 959 in the showroom, and a Ferrari F40 at the same time. And they were used to me coming across and pressing my face against the glass.
968 was made from 92 to 95, and it's kind of almost halfway between a 944 and a 928. It kind of looks like a combination of these cars. Lovely looking thing, and the club sport especially desirable as well these days. It was a very limited run model. You don't see very many of those cars, but again, because of that rarity, that's one of the reasons why they're desirable, and one of the reasons why I expect that they won't lose any value or lose any money anytime soon. They've actually seen a wee resurgence in price, the 968 Club Sport as well. It's seen a wee appreciation fairly recently, as have most transaxle Porsches. But the 968 is it's a bit less unknown. You don't see very many of them, but that, in my opinion, is a car that's going to probably appreciate in value, I would say. So yeah, the 968.
Earlier on the video, that any air-cooled 911 is desirable, and any special edition of an air-cooled 911 is especially desirable. And what could be more special than the 911 Turbo? The original 911 Turbo, what a fantastic, beautiful looking machine. That was the poster, bedroom poster car for quite a lot of us, including me. And it was sometimes called the 930, it's built from 1975 to 1989.
And the
wide
rear,
and the front was widened as well to help with the track. But the 930 is a kind of quintessential 911 Turbo, if you like. It's the most recognisable one. And these cars are very special, obviously, and these cars have got an special historical importance, which gives them some added punch. So yeah, any 911 turbo is a very special thing, but the original 911 turbo, being the first, the 930, is wonderful, and it's basically, I don't see that losing any money. In fact, I think that's going to just climb and climb as time goes on. So the 930 turbo from 1975 to 1989.
1981 to 1993, we've got the Type 964 turbo.
Again, air-cooled 911, and that's fantastic. You know, it's very, very similar to the 930 in how it looks. It's got bigger front and back bumpers. Still, the silhouette's pretty much identical to the 930 before it. These cars are made in short and in small numbers, the 3.3 and the 3.6. I'll just explain briefly why Porsche number their cars. I mean, you might be a bit confused by all these 964, you know, 968, 928. Why do Porsche name their cars after, well, number their cars, I should say? Well, the reason for that is because Porsche was originally an engineering firm with various projects that they just called, named by number, basically. So you had project number 1, 2, 3 and 4. That's how they came up with the numbers. They used to build gearboxes and various engine components for various other manufacturers, and they were all given a number. In fact, when the 911 was created, they were on number 901, so they called their 911 the 901 originally, and that's what it was called in badged as when it first became released. But Peugeot actually objected to it because Peugeot owned the copyright to any vehicle with a zero in the middle. So Porsche naturally did the logical thing and went from a 901 to a 911. They simply added a 1 rather than a 0. That was the next logical numerical number. And the 911 legend was born. That's how it came around. So Porsche named their project by number because of that.
The turbo was from 1995 to 1998.
Again, it's a very special one. Even amongst these special 911s, this is a particularly special because it's the last of the air-cooled 911 turbos. Again, it looks very similar to the 993. Only it has a wider body. The 993's actually got quite a wide looking body, but the 993 turbo is even wider still. And again, pretty rare, pretty special. And you get a Turbo S as well. And these cars will always have a place in history because they are the last of the air-cooled 911s. And prices are definitely going to reflect that. And these are cars that I would anticipate are probably going to climb in value even further.
996 911 turbo was the first of the water-cooled turbos.
So again, it's quite special in that regard because it's the first of a line of particular types of vehicles. So that was built from 2001 to 2005. Very different animal for all the cars before it. We won't go into that in this video, but air-cooled versus water-cooled, you know, they're very distinct, very different beasts.
But the 996 turbo is a fantastic machine as well, of course, and it's one of these cars, I would imagine, that's actually started climbing in value fairly recently.
I remember a time when these cars were half the value what they are now. Same with a lot of cars, you know, that's hindsight for you. But the 996 turbo is certainly up there with the group of special cars that are going to hold their value, I would expect. The 997 turbo is the last of the 911 turbos. The Metzer, you've probably heard that expression before. A Metzer engine is just pretty much anything that's based around the air-cooled 911's architecture. Very robust engines. We had their roots in motorsport, actually. Distinctive, robust, high quality, very durable. Different from a lot of the other kind of mainstream water-cooled Porsches, including this. But yeah, the 997 turbo is up there as well. I'm going to stop there with the 911 turbos because after that, 991 became turbocharged as standard, albeit you've got 911 turbos type 991 and 992 and beyond, and they're all very special and very wonderful in their own way. But we'll stop there at the 997 types for 911 turbos, and we'll start to talk about other things like desirable Porsches that are very rare and expensive, like the hypercar supercars. You know, we touched on the 959, it's also a very expensive car, but you know, anything basically, like any 911 that's a special variant, like a Turbo.
It's like the very special Porsche 918 Spyder, that's a hybrid supercar.
These cars were always expensive, and as you can imagine, they're always going to be historically important, they're always going to hold their money well. These are cars that are certainly going to hold their money, if not climb quite a bit, I would say. But you know, these kind of these supercars, they're kind of in a slightly different bracket to the point of this video, which is really just to give you a kind of basic overview of the types of cars. If you're new to Porsche, you maybe want to know what kind of Porsches are most likely to hold their value. And this video is really just intended to give you a wee idea of the types of models that are that are most likely to hold their value over the long term.
2003 Carrera GT, which again I've actually seen, I've sat in one of those as well.
I was very surprised way back when, you know, I was actually cycling out near here and a silver one rolled past me. I couldn't quite believe it. But it sounds fantastic, by the way. But yeah, that's a car that, as you know, same as a 918 Spider, it's very special, very rare, very expensive. As you can imagine, these cars aren't... they're not going to plummet under normal circumstances. It's a common sense, I guess, that these cars are going to hold their money if not climb quite a bit.
Hey guys, thanks for taking time to watch this little video. Hope you've enjoyed it.
If you have, give us a wee thumbs up, subscribe to the channel for more Porsche-related content. And any comments, I'd love to read your comments below. And if you're interested in my Porsche journey and my Porsche books, then by all means check them out. I'll put the links below for you guys. Right guys, until the next video, thanks again for watching and I'll see you next time. Cheers.